Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. The woke madness in history education is off the rails. Well, how do we change it? McClanahanacademy.com. And because you listen to this podcast, if you use the coupon code PODCAST at checkout, you get 25% off every day, all day, 365 days a year on every class at McClanahanacademy.com. So go to McClanahanacademy.com, use coupon code PODCAST at checkout, and get a real history education at 25% off. If you like this podcast and you want it without advertisements, head over to patreon.com and become a member of the Brion McClanahan Show. For $10 a month, you get all the podcasts ad-free, including video, and you also get a special Q&A podcast. I'm only going to answer your questions, your listener-generated episodes, through those Q&As. So, head over to patreon.com, get this podcast ad-free, no ads, not even things like this, and you really do help support the Brion McClanahan Show with really cool stuff on the back end. Get the book that Kevin Gutzman called the single best volume on original intent ever written, My Founding Fathers' Guide to the Constitution. It is the book. When people ask me what's my favorite, that's the one. Pick it up wherever books are sold online and get a real education on the Constitution. In January of this year, I warned you that the rhetoric of the Democratic Party was going to be dangerous. Well, we've seen what's happened now, and I'll talk about that on this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show.
It's time to think locally and act locally. Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad you're back on the program. Very glad to be here. Here we are, my 1,000th episode week. This is episode 999. And maybe it's fitting that all the things that have happened that I've talked about on this show over the last 8 years are now all starting to happen. I mean, in January of this year, I said that Biden's first campaign speech, go back and listen to that episode. January, I think it was January 9th I put that episode. It was one of the first episodes I did this year. I said Biden's most recent campaign ad, his first real campaign ad of 2024, was one of the most dangerous things that I've ever seen. And what's happened? Well, we just saw. We saw what happened to Donald Trump. And of course, unfortunately, one Trump supporter and a couple of Trump supporters that were injured too over this past weekend. And this is what I predicted would happen. I said this was the 1850s all over again. In fact, I've been saying that for about 8 years, since Trump first ran for president back in 2016. In fact, this week is going to be a little reflection. I thought about doing an interview, bringing somebody on to talk about something fun. But I think there's far too many things going on right now that are really important to talk about heading into this election season. As I'm recording this, the Republican convention is being held. I might talk about that a little bit this week. But all the way back in 2016, when I first launched this show, in fact, I launched it in 2016. My very first episode, the very first couple of episodes, in fact, were on Donald Trump and Ted Cruz. At that time, I talked about Ted Cruz as a candidate. I talked about Trump and federalism. What was Trump going to be like as a candidate? Was he going to be really committed to federalism or not? We know Trump is a nationalist. We know that the Republican Party has basically been the same Republican Party for the last 150 plus years. Nothing's really changed there. In fact, Donald Trump in many ways is nothing more than a New Deal Democrat, which the New Deal Democrats were much like the 1860s Republicans. So we've seen that leftist kind of Republican Party become mainstream. Parties, the Democratic Party adopted much of what was the Republican Party at one time, and now we've seen the Democratic Party move far left. The Republican Party is still pretty much what it always has been. So we don't have a conservative party anymore. But regardless, the rhetoric being used by the Democrats was bound to result in what we saw over the weekend at the Trump rally. I predicted it. I've predicted it for 8 years. I've said this is going to happen. I've talked about the 1850s. And I've mentioned that some of the things that are happening are really dangerous. Now, last week I talked about Rome quite a bit and that we hadn't gotten to the point yet where we're starting to take out our political opponents. And in so many ways, we've been in this general lull in this kind of political violence in America. We haven't seen a candidate or any kind of major political figure assassinated since the 1960s in America. We've seen a candidate wounded, 1972, George Wallace. We saw Gerald Ford shot at twice, both times, in fact, by a bunch of lunatic women. I mean, that's the funniest thing about that. It was two women that shot at Gerald Ford. You just don't think that would be the case. And then, of course, we saw Ronald Reagan shot in 1981. But we haven't seen anything like that since. Now, it doesn't mean that there hasn't been efforts that have been thwarted by American security or police forces. We know that some of these things go on, that there have been plots at various times. We saw George W. Bush get a shoe thrown at his head when he was overseas, which, I mean, the video that he's laughing at the guy is kind of funny, in effect. But we haven't seen anything like this. Trump was an inch away from being assassinated on live television. And we have a bunch of lunatics running around out there that are have been stoked by the rhetoric, the violent rhetoric of the left. Now, years ago, and this was one of the first 25 episodes, I did one on the Brion McClanahan Show. This was 2016 as well, talking about how the left is the most dangerous and violent political faction in the history of Western civilization. Nothing has changed. We don't know much about this lunatic, this idiotic, dopey little soy boy shooter that was taken out that day. We don't know much about his politics, but I can almost guarantee you he was being stoked by the very rhetoric that the Democrats have been using for years. When you say that your opponent, Donald Trump, is literally Hitler, and I mean, that's what they've said. I mean, you've got the New Republic with Trump being shown as Hitler. Well, then, I mean, at that point, what have you just done? You've demonized your political opponent, an American political opponent, to the point where we know in World War II our enemy was the Nazis. And so now you've made Americans out to be these kind of people. And it's not just Trump. It's all the Trump supporters. And I'm actually going to go back to a speech that Joe Biden made. It's the very famous Dark Brandon speech, and I want to cover some of the rhetoric in that speech, because now Joe Biden has appeared on television on Sunday night, and he's trying to calm down America. We need to go to the battle box. not with bullets. We got to go to the battle box to do these things. I wonder what, you know, when I think of battle box, I'm thinking of, like, you know, robot fighting time on, the the robot wars there on, what is it, Discovery Channel or whatever it's on now. This is funny. Or maybe Night Fight. That was one of my favorite shows, Night Fight. It was on for one season. The year before COVID, Night Fight was on. And then it only had one season. It was great, though. Night combat arena kind of stuff. But anyways, we've got Joe Biden now trying to calm America, as the man and his idiotic speech team has ramped up all of this stuff over 4 years. We saw it when Biden was running for president. We saw what the left was trying to do in the period of time when Trump was president. And now we see the end result of that. And they're not going to take any responsibility for this. In fact, they're putting, well, this is all his fault. I mean, it's not our fault. It's not our fault that we run around saying Trump has a bullseye on him or anything like that. It's not our fault. That's not our fault. When you say things like this, lunatics will be lunatics. And I think it's very important to understand rhetoric has consequences. Language has consequences. Again, let's go back to the 1850s. Before the 1850s, we had some relatively, at times you would have some heated rhetoric between the North and South. But by the 1850s, this had gotten really nasty, to the point where you did have violence on the floors of Congress. You had, of course, Charles Sumner beaten unconscious by Preston Brooks. And Southerners cheered that at the time because Charles Sumner was making very inflammatory remarks about the South. Charles Sumner called Southerners vomit. You had Henry Ward Beecher call Southerners devils. In fact, there's a letter by James Byard of Delaware, writing to his son. And when I was working on my dissertation on Byron, came across this letter where he mentions what Henry Ward Beecher said. And he basically points this out. If this is what we're doing, if this is the kind of rhetoric coming out of the North, we're doomed. because you have dehumanized your opponents. If you say that Trump is this, you know, antichrist, essentially, he's Hitler, he's all these bad things, if that's what you're saying, well, then you've just dehumanized Trump. It doesn't matter. And anybody that gets in the way, the poor firefighter that was protecting his family and killed by that, horrible. Well, that person, to some people on the left, wouldn't matter. And we saw that kind of rhetoric even after this happened. Some people on the left were saying some really stupid things. This is a disaster in many ways. What we're facing is Rome, but also the 1850s. And I hope the end result of this is not what happened in the 1860s. I don't think that Americans want that. I mean, you're around your daily life. Nobody wants this kind of nastiness. But the only solution to this, and I've said it before, and I said it in January of 2024, here we are in July. I said, this is the most dangerous political speech Biden has ever made. We're here 7 months later, and look what's happened. And now he's trying to, oh, we got to be calm. But I'm going to go back, and I'm going to read the rhetoric of one of Biden's speeches. And you tell me if Joe Biden can be trusted to calm the waters. The only thing that will solve these problems is real federalism in America. Think about all the issues. Why is it that everyone is so angry? It's something I've talked about on the show. This week, I'm going to revisit some of the themes I've been talking about for 8 years. Why are Americans so angry? Well, it's pretty easy. Pretty easy to understand. When you nationalize every issue, when you make every issue about the center, us versus them, and you have a 50% on both sides, essentially 50%, plus a very small group on the winning side. And I'll say that. I think Joe Biden, if you believe the numbers that we got out of 2020, won by about, 3 million votes, something like that. Well, you think about how small that is. In a country of 330 million people, that's 1%. 1% of the American population, if you just want to lump everybody together, is dictating to the other half of the population what we need to do. Is that fair? Is that a real majority? Is that a real mandate to do any of these things? No. But in a state like, say, California, where the left is a supermajority, or a state like Alabama, where the right is a supermajority, well, that is a mandate. The people there want to live a certain way. And if you are in the minority in those states, well, it kind of stinks. So you can vote with your feet. Or you can try to change minds, whatever it is. But the fact is, we have razor-thin majorities. And the last time we really had this situation really was Reconstruction in America. When, if you go out and look at your political maps, it wasn't the 1860s. It wasn't the 1850s. But when you had these really divided and very tight elections, very slim majorities winning elections, it was the 1870s, the 1880s, and into the 1890s. Very close elections. By the time you turn the 20th century, things change a little bit. Teddy Roosevelt won in a landslide in 1904. And, you know, William McKinley did pretty well in 1900. And then you get 1908 again, a pretty sizable majority for the Republicans in 08. 1912, you had all these candidates. So it was, you know, again, pretty close race because you had four candidates. But what we've seen more and more in the 20th century into the 21st century is a little bit larger margin of victory, except for a few elections. We're going back to the 1870s and 1880s. It's not the 1860s, even though the rhetoric is the 1850s or maybe the 1860s. I mean, we have it happening all the time. Just look at the Confederate monuments issue. Those monuments were put up during a period of reconciliation, when we were trying to heal the wounds of the war, when you actually had Union veterans and they were saying, we need to shake hands with Confederate veterans and this is going to recognize everybody. And hey, we're all one country again and this is great and we're going to have one vision moving forward. You know, you're a Northerner, I'm a Southerner, whatever it is. And we're going to do things in the best interest of America and the stars and stripes forever. And we're going to sing God Bless America and we're going to sing the Star Spangled Banner and we're going to do all this wonderful stuff. But that all went away in the last several years. I mean, look at the naming commission. There is no effort anymore at reconciliation. The effort is not to bridge differences, but to tear down things that people don't like. That's the rhetoric of the Democratic Party. It's the rhetoric of the Biden administration. It's the rhetoric of the left, because the left is very good at destroying things. They're not so good at building things up. The things they build up have to be held together with threats of violence. It's the way it's always been. It's the way it always will be, because they live in a utopian world, and what they really want usually doesn't work. That's the problem. So here we are. We've actually had an attempt on the life of a presidential candidate. Horrible news. Horrible. One person unfortunately lost their life in that, who was a bystander. I'm not really worried about the idiot that tried it. That's not unfortunate. But we do have a real threatening situation developing in America. If Trump had actually had lost his life, I can only imagine what would have happened. It would have been a real disaster. I think you would have seen some political violence in America that happened. And people are saying this might have handed Trump the presidency. I don't know. Maybe. I don't think that Joe Biden's going to step aside. I don't know if the Democrats are going to be able to spin this well enough to get out of this, because I think people are starting to realize that the rhetoric they have used, and they know it, which is why they're trying to backpedal and gaslight. Oh, this is something we can't do. You've got them all saying it now, even though they've all been responsible for this for 8 years. The left has created this scenario, and now they don't know what to do about it. So I'm going to go back to this Joe Biden speech. Now, this is not the speech that he gave in January of 2024 at all. It's not. But this is a speech that Joe Biden gave that was, inflammatory, to say the least. I mean, there's no other way to describe it. Now, this speech is September 1st, 2022. So this goes back almost 2 years now. And again, this is the Dark Brandon speech. This is a speech where people stepped back and said, what did he just do? He had the imagery of the red and the lighting there at Independence Hall is very, very foreboding. People might even say fascist. I mean, who are the real fascists in America? We know it's the left. We know fascism is a leftist ideology. All ideologies in many ways come down to a leftist position. That's what they are. But this speech it's remarkable for what he says in it. So let me get into it. He talks about the Constitution, of course, the Declaration of Independence, which has this Lincolnian kind of myth-making in it. This is where America made its Declaration of Independence to the world more than two centuries ago, with an idea unique among nations that in America we're all created equal. I mean, again, this is Lincolnian myth-making to the nth degree. That's what this is all about. But notice what he does later on in the speech. And if you've never heard this before, maybe you didn't pay attention to it. This is almost 2 years ago. And to say that this is somehow, if you listen to his little attempt to calm the waters, so to speak, on Sunday night, which he pre-recorded, 6 minutes, even made mistakes in a pre-recorded address. I mean, how ridiculous. You would think that the only violence we've had, political violence in America, came from the right. You would think that because if you've seen an image of his speechwriters, it's a bunch of millennial or Generation Z morons sitting in a little room, mostly women, who aren't going to take the blame for anything. They didn't do any of this stuff. But look at what he says. "But as I stand here tonight," he said, "equality and democracy are under assault. We do ourselves no favor to pretend otherwise. Democracy and equality are under assault." Well, if that's the case, if those things are really under assault, what are you going to do about it? He says, "So tonight, I have come this place where it all began to speak as plainly as I can to the nation about the threats we face, about the power we have in our own hands to meet these threats, and about the incredible future that lies in front of us if we only choose it. We must never forget, we the people are the true heirs of the American experiment that began more than two centuries ago. We the people have burning inside each of us the flame of liberty that was lit here at Independence Hall, a flame that lit our way through abolition, the Civil War, suffrage, the Great Depression, world wars, and civil rights." Notice all the things that he just said there. Those are all left-wing causes, for the most part. And the way they responded to that, abolition was through violence, the Civil War, violence, suffrage. Not through violence, though there was some violence involved at times. The Great Depression, government. World wars, violence, civil rights, both peaceful and violent. But those are all leftist things he mentions. That's the trajectory of America. To Joe Biden and the dopey speechwriters that he employs, that's what we've had. See, America was left from the beginning. And all these things are a realization of the leftist trajectory. And anybody that gets in the way with that, in the way of that, I should say, is a threat to equality and democracy. And if you're a threat to those things, well, what do you do with people that are a threat? He says, "That sacred flame still burns now in our own time as we build an America that is more prosperous, free, and just. That is the work of my presidency, a mission I believe in with my whole soul. But first, we must be honest with each other and with ourselves. Too much of what's happening today in our country today is not normal. Not normal. Too much that is happening is not normal." I agree. Though if you look at the history of the world and you look at the history of Rome, you could say these things are kind of normal because this is what happens to empires as they become so corrupt. And that's what America has become. Then the kicker, Donald Trump and the MAGA Republicans represent an extremism that threatens the very foundations of our republic. Donald Trump and the MAGA Republicans represent an extremism that threatens the very foundations of our republic. Not Joe Biden here has now taken a stand. This is in 2022. My political opponents are enemies of all of this stuff I just mentioned. And they're trying to destroy the United States. And if that's the case, as I said in January, this 1850s rhetoric, if that's the case, well, we're really in trouble, aren't we? And I could go back to the speech in January. You can go back and watch that show. And I talked about this speech. But again, I want to put all this in context. This is what I've been saying now for years. For years, this is what's going to happen. Now, I'm not alone in this. Other people have done this as well. But I was sounding this alarm back in 2016. And the amazing thing about that line, people cheered. When Joe Biden made that statement, it's even written. Now, I want to be very clear, applause. As he said that line, the dopes sitting there at Independence Hall or the Philadelphia State House were cheering. When he said, Donald Trump and MAGA Republicans are a threat to the foundations of our republic. You see? They cheered. They didn't say, well, wait a second. I mean, you're demonizing 50% of the American population. Now, he tries. Well, I want to be clear. Not every Republican, not even the majority of Republicans, are MAGA Republicans. False. Not every Republican embraces their extreme ideology. What is that? What is their extreme ideology? Nobody's ever able to define this stuff. In fact, as I've said on this show, Donald Trump is not extreme if you just position him against, say, Franklin Roosevelt, who generally had the same views, or even Abraham Lincoln, who generally had the same views. He's only extreme if you are far on the left. Then he's extreme. The left thinks anyone kind of in the middle is extreme because you're not far on the left. And this is what R.L. Dabney pointed out in the 1880s. American conservatism is just taking the discarded positions of the left. Donald Trump is not a right. I mean, he's not far right on really anything. His position that the presidency has almost unlimited power has been embraced by every president, left or right, in the last 100 plus years, 160 years. Abraham Lincoln said the same thing. And yet we love Abraham Lincoln, but when somebody says it that you don't like, well, that's dangerous. I mean, we've seen this out of virtually every president since World War II, and yet he's now extreme. You see, it's the use of language and the gaslighting that goes on. They want to make you believe that Joe Biden is none of these things, but he is all of these things. That Joe Biden said nothing wrong. You got a 6-minute Oval Office discussion that ignores Joe Biden's role. I guess I'm surprised they haven't tried to scrub all this stuff off the internet. They can't. But if they could, they would, because then you could just say Joe Biden never said any of that stuff. And then what he says is this. But there is no question that the Republican Party today is dominated, driven, and intimidated by Donald Trump and the MAGA Republicans. And that is a threat to this country. Well, if it's a threat, what do you do with it? And you think, I mean, this is how you have to think. You've got a bunch of crazy, mentally unstable people that support the Democrats all over the place in America. And if you're saying that that person is a threat, well, what do you do with that? It's a threat to this country. Well, what do you do with that? Well, you have to eliminate that threat. He says, these are hard things. But I'm an American president, not the president of red America or blue America, but of all America, really. Doesn't sound like it here. Sounds like you're the president of a blue America against, and you are now essentially having a writ of attainder against half the population, because that's what you're doing. And I believe it is my duty to level with you, to tell the truth, no matter how difficult, no matter how painful. And here, in my view, is what is true. MAGA Republicans do not respect the Constitution. They do not believe in the rule of law. They do not recognize the will of the people. They refuse to accept the results of a free election. And they're working right now, as I speak, in state after state to give power to decide elections in America to partisans and cronies, empowering election deniers to undermine democracy itself. MAGA forces are determined to take this country backwards. Backwards to an America where there is no right to choose, no right to privacy, no right to contraception, no right to marry who you love. They promote authoritarian leaders, and they fan the flames of political violence that are a threat to our personal rights, to the pursuit of justice, to the rule of law, to the very soul of this country. You see? This is their fault. It's not Joe Biden's fault. It's their fault. But if you say these people are the threat like this, well, what is the result? And the last time in America you really saw something like this was the 1850s. And as I said in January, the end result of that, Yankees go crazy about every 60 years, and It's been about that time. 1960s, they went nuts. They're going nuts now in the 2020s. And we saw some radical transformative things in the 1960s. And we saw political violence. We had John F. Kennedy killed in the 1960s. Robert F. Kennedy killed. Martin Luther King killed. We saw a lot of political violence in the 60s. Some of that pursued perhaps by the government itself, depending on what you believe in those various things. But regardless, we saw it. We saw George Wallace shot in 1972. Are we back to that point in America now, where you have a bunch of nut jobs running around there trying to do this? Gosh, I hope not. I hope we haven't resorted to a period of time where political violence becomes the answer for the people on the left. But when you have this kind of rhetoric, and Joe Biden can try to gaslight all he wants and gets up there and say, well, you know, this is not something I support. It's not something. You just read this speech 2 years ago, not even. And your political ad in January was the exact same thing. You've demonized the other side. You've made them out to the drunken vomit and spew of an uneasy civilization, which is what Charles Sumner called Southerners. This is what you've done. These are the deplorables. These are the non-people. They're not even people. They're subhuman. And when you make your opponent subhuman, when you make them less than human, which is what you reduce them to, just a bunch of bumpkins who don't deserve anything, this is what you get. And so, as I predicted in January of 2024, as I said this week, I'm going to do some reflection on some things. The 1000th episode tomorrow is going to be a lot about reflection. As we're reflecting on things this week, it's important to think back about that. I mean, I've told you, I've steered you right from the beginning. Left is the most dangerous and violent political left is the most dangerous and violent group of people in the history of Western civilization. They're showing it on a regular basis now. They're showing it on a regular basis. They are what they are, which is dangerous. They're destructive. They tear down. They don't really even know what to do with it. They just tear it down. And the end result of that is chaos, instability, and of course, more and more power for the center, because that's what they really want. More and more power for the center. I want to, before we get to 1,000, just close with this. I do want to thank a lot of you have been around for all 1,000 episodes, or close to it, 999 of them. And I do want to thank every one of you for being there that whole time. Some people have asked, you know, on various podcast websites, why don't they have the first 15 episodes? If you want to get those, you can get them on YouTube. I don't know why they didn't pick them up, why they don't have them. It's news to me. I mean, I don't know why they didn't do it. But for those that have been here for 1,000 or close to it, thank you for that. Of course, you can always get on Patreon and continue to support the show. I will tell you what I think is going to happen all the time, and hopefully I haven't steered you wrong or led you astray in these things. My job is to simply say, look, this is the historical precedent for this stuff. This is what I can see. I can read the tea leaves and say this is where we're going because of history. I talked about it last week, Rome. And I know there's other people doing this stuff. But I am very concerned at this point. Here we are, July of 2024. I said in January of 2024, we've got some issues. I said in 2016, we have some issues. The things don't look good. And so this is my greatest fear, that things are going to move in that direction of the 1850s. I sure hope not. But when you have a major political party demonizing the other side, calling them essentially enemies of the state, because that's what they're doing, enemies of the founding, enemies of democracy, the republic, the constitution. Well, those people don't deserve to exist. I mean, for some nut jobs. This is what they're going to think. And it's unfortunate. But that rhetoric does need to be toned down. I don't know if the left is capable of it. But you really want to see where the blame comes? It's that. 8 years of this. 8 years of this kind of rhetoric. You didn't see it when, George W. Bush was president, or, you know, McCain or Romney were running. Why? Because they were establishment people. And the left likes establishment people because establishment people to them. When I say establishment, what I mean by that, these people have been in Congress. They played the same game. They weren't wrecking balls. And Trump really isn't going to do a whole lot. I mean, Trump is one of them, too. I go back to that very famous comedy skit with Dave Chappelle, and he said, you know why Trump irritates them? Because he was in the House doing all the illegal stuff. He walks out of the House, and he says, all those things you believe are happening here, it's all true. And he walks back in the House. And they're furious with him because he just exposed it all. That's why they don't like him. And of course, when you ramp up the rhetoric about these people are dangerous, and you've got all this Project 2025 stuff circulating around now, which is just so stupid. The way the left is going ballistic over all this stuff. Social media is a cesspool. But this is what they're doing, and they're trying to make it to where their political opponents are less than human. I'm going to tell you, I mean, I've got friends on the left, I've got friends on the right. And I think most Americans see through this stuff. And they're just like, you know, this is silly. But I do see some real danger in the kind of rhetoric the left is using now. And it's done on purpose. Their effort is to destabilize. And when they get caught, they're going to gaslight, which is what Joe Biden was doing. All you got to do is pull up his previous speeches, previous political campaign ads, any of that stuff. It's all there. They all know it, which is why they're all running around now trying to gaslight and cover themselves, because they know they are 100% responsible for the way the rhetoric has been heated up in America over the last 8 years. They are 100% responsible for it. See you next time on the Brion McClanahan Show. See you then.